Good morning. Gene is accusing me of being late. I promise you that I've been here, present and accounted for. I was over in the conference room making sure that the transmission from that thing back there to YouTube to the in-house TV channel was properly working. I think it is. In just a moment after I offer a prayer and during Nancy's prelude, I'm going to step back there again. I've heard a few things from a few folks who tune in to TV 971 that it doesn't work. And of course, I can't work out the kinks when I'm up here, so I'm trying to race back and make sure we get it all squared away. But it is so good to be with you today. It's a beautiful spring day outside, and here we are this third Sunday in Lent. As I mentioned 2 weeks ago, I wasn't here last week, of course, Rivermont was, and you'll see in the sermon title, it's called The Green Mile, with the addition this week of repentance. We're calling it The Green Mile, playing off of the blockbuster hit movie based off the Stephen King novel that is about inmates on death row and how the hallway, the Green Mile, was the color of faded limes. And I'm using that because our Green Mile leads towards certain death, just like in that movie. But our Green Mile of Lent also leads to life, to renewed and transformed life. Just wanted to fill you in on that before we got going, since there was a break last week from our Lenten theme. I offer this prayer, and again, I will slip out during the prelude and then slip right back in just to make sure everything's going well. Everything's copacetic, as my mom says. I don't know what copacetic means. I couldn't spell it if you asked me to. But we're hoping that it's going to be kaopectate or something. All right, let's pray as we prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Almighty God, you know that we have no power in ourselves to help ourselves. Keep us both outwardly in our bodies and inwardly in our souls, that we may be defended from all adversities which may happen to the body, and from all evil thoughts which may assault and hurt the soul, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Please join me in reading responsibly this call to worship. Everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, seek the Lord. Repent and return so that you may live. All who are hungry for righteousness, come to the waters, seek the Lord. Repent and return so that you may live. All who need the help of God, come to the waters, seek the Lord. Repent and return so that you may live. Continuing, responding accordingly with Psalm 33, verses 1 through 8. O God, you are my God, I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you. As in a dry and weary land where there is no water. So I have looked upon you in the sanctuary, beholding your power and glory. Because your steadfast love is better than life, my lips will praise you. So I will bless you as long as I live. I will lift up my hands and call on your name. My soul is satisfied as with a rich feast, and my mouth shall with joyful lips. When I think of you on my bed and meditate on you in the watches of the night, for you have been my help, and in the shadow of your wings I sing for joy. My soul clings to you. Your right hand upholds me. Thank you. came from the prophet Isaiah. Everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. And you that have no money, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me and eat what is good, and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Listen so that you may live. I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. See, I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander for the peoples. See, you shall call nations that you do not know, and nations that do not know you shall run to you, because the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their ways, and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them return to the Lord, that he may have mercy on them, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Do you think that because you have spoken hurtfully or failed to help or left God behind as you travel through each day that God forgets you? God's love is as constant as the sun. God's forgiveness is as sure as the stars in the night sky. Let us confess our sin to God, whose love is steadfast and whose forgiveness is sure. The thirsty come, and we offer lead-filled water. The hungry come, and we offer a single can from our overflowing pantries. The lonely come, and we cling to our close circles. The broken come, and we hand them an aspirin. The needy come, but we have wasted everything on stuff we do not need. Have mercy on us, steadfast love, and pour your heart into our grace-parched souls. As you have been with us in every moment, may we go to be with all around us. May we listen to the needs and hearts of others, even as you lean down to listen to us in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. God's love is sure and steadfast, always providing a way out, a way through, a way back to God. Through God's grace, we have died with Christ and are raised with him. With gratitude, in faith, we walk the way of Christ. Give thanks to God, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
yeah, we're going to start over.
We're going to start over because I can't transpose in my mind.
We're going to sing that one over. It's a good one anyway. There's a blindness in thank Nancy as well as June, who are our two primary pianists. Sometimes I throw them curveballs with hymns, maybe a familiar tune, a different text, or maybe a new hymn all together. And I thank you all as well for bearing with me. I hope you're aware, when I'm planning these worship services, I like for the thread to continue from the very beginning to the very end. Though I am a big fan of just singing some of the good old hymns and things like that. But sometimes I throw in these different ones and different things that may be less familiar, but I hope is no less filling for your spirit and your soul. We seek you in your word, O God, as though we are searching for water in a dry and weary land. By the power of your Holy Spirit, may this word be to us a rich feast, satisfying the soul. Then with our mouths we will praise you, and with our lives we will serve you, our host and our hope. Amen. A reading from Paul's first letter to the Corinthian church. I do not want you to be unaware, brothers and sisters, that our ancestors were all under the cloud, and all passed through the sea, and all were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. And all ate the same spiritual food, and all drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank from the spiritual rock that followed them. And the rock was Christ. Nevertheless, God was not pleased with most of them, and they were struck down in the wilderness. Now these things occurred as examples for us, so that we might not desire evil as they did. Do not become idolaters, as some of them did. As it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink, and they rose up to play. We must not indulge in sexual immorality, as some of them did, and 23,000 fell in a single day. We must not put Christ to the test, as some of them did, and were destroyed by serpents. And do not complain, as some of them did, and were destroyed by the destroyer. These things happened to them to serve as an example, and they were written down to instruct us on whom the ends of the ages have come. So if you think you are standing, watch out that you do not fall. No testing has overtaken you that is not common to everyone. God is faithful, and he will not let you be tested beyond your strength. But with the testing, he will also provide the way out so that you may be able to endure it. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And now the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. At that very time, there were some present who told him about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. He asked them, "Do you think that because these Galileans suffered in this way, they were worse sinners than all other Galileans? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will also perish as they did. Or those 18 who were killed when the tower of Siloam fell on them. Do you think that they were worse offenders than all the others living in Jerusalem? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all perish just as they did." Then he told this parable. A man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came looking for fruit on it and found none. So he said to the gardener, "See here, for 3 years I have come looking for fruit on this fig tree, and still I find none. Cut it down. Why should it be wasting the soil?" He replied, "Sir, let it alone for one more year until I dig around it and put manure on it. If it bears fruit next year, well and good. But if not, you can cut it down." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. If you were to Google most comforting verses or stories in the Bible, I can guarantee you that these two passages from Paul's letter to the Corinthians and from the Gospel of Luke would not make the cut. Jesus does not seek to comfort the crowd here in this gospel, but to challenge them. According to Luke's account, the crowd didn't explicitly ask anything of Jesus, but Jesus' response revealed their question. This question can be articulated in many different ways, but they were wrestling with what I like to call the great imponderable, which is summed up in a one-word question: why? Did their sinfulness cause their tragic deaths? What sin was committed by those whom Pilate slaughtered to merit such a violent death? Why? But at least it's not us. By imagining that those who are facing disasters and tragedies somehow deserve their misfortune made them feel a bit safer and a bit better about themselves. It seems as though the crowd was looking for assurance that their fate would not be the same as those other sinners. And how does Jesus answer this question that they didn't ask, yet he provided the answer for? Repent or die. Thank you for the comfort, Jesus. Later in the 13th chapter of Luke's gospel, we read that Jesus desired to be like a mother hen, gathering in the children of Jerusalem to be held in the shelter and comfort of protective, nurturing wings. Well, this ain't no mother hen Jesus here. Repent or die. Well, there was more to Jesus' response than this jolting ultimatum. Jesus responded to their questions. Again, the questions they didn't ask, but that they were asking in themselves. Do you think that these Galileans were somehow being singled out for their sins? That they were worse than any other Galileans because they suffered this terrible death? Of course not. But listen, if you do not consider God's ways and truly change, then friends, you should prepare to face his judgment and eternal death. Repent or die. And speaking of current events, Jesus continued, you've all heard about the 18 people who were killed in the building accident when the tower of Siloam fell. Were they extraordinarily bad people, worse than anyone else in Jerusalem, so that they would deserve such an untimely and tragic death? Of course not. But all the buildings of Jerusalem will come crashing down on you if you do not wake up and change direction now. Repent or die. Jesus barely paused to catch a breath when he jumped right into a parable about a fig tree and manure. The landowner was ready to cut it down. The barren fig tree was taking up space in the orchard and wasn't fulfilling its one and only purpose, to bear fruit. But the branches were empty. Cut it down. But the hired hand, the gardener, steps up to the landowner and says, let me work with it one more year. Give it another chance. I'll dig around it. I'll fertilize it. I'll prune it. And well, it'll be great if it does bear fruit. But if not, then we can cut it down. But let's take one more chance. One more year. I promise it's going to work. This discomforting directive of Jesus, repent or die, is teeming with a sense of urgency. But it's quickly followed by the patient plea of the vineyard keeper to give the fruitless fig tree a little more time to bear fruit. And so we're confronted with a paradox. On one hand, sin is a disease and penitence is a matter of life and death. Death is imminent. So it is immediately necessary for us to confess our sins and turn from them, which ultimately leads to salvation. But on the other hand, we have a vineyard keeper who is willing to patiently tend to us and to cultivate true repentance, which leads to transformation in this life. It leads to fruit production. Maybe this is not meant to be a paradoxical conundrum. Maybe this isn't either or, but both and. The juxtaposition of urgent repentance and patient reprieve is really the heart of the good news of Jesus. Today's gospel lesson speaks both to justification and sanctification. Simply put, justification means that we are declared righteous by the grace of God. Sanctification means that we are growing in righteousness with God. Justification happens outside of you, and sanctification happens inside of you. Both justification and sanctification are gifts of grace. You see, justification is that one-time act whereby God declares a sinner like you and me not guilty. Forgiven. Because of Jesus, we are justified by grace through faith. Though we have been indicted and convicted, we are not condemned nor sentenced, but rather we are acquitted. Though our sinfulness deserves retribution, we are declared righteous for eternity because of the grace of God through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. Sanctification, on the other hand, is the daily and gradual process of being made into the image of Christ. It is the fulfillment of the divine purpose enunciated in the words, "Be holy as I am holy." To be sanctified means to be set apart, to be made holy. Sanctification is transformation and restoration where we are able to work to make things right between ourselves and God and others. I'm an amateur woodworker. Specifically wood turning. And I love a good analogy, so bear with me. Justification is like a brand new gouge or a chisel. It's got a perfectly sharp edge from the manufacturer. I take it over to the lathe, I crank up the RPMs, and the gouge delicately slices through the spinning wood. It cuts like butter, and ribbons of wood come flying off. It's really a beautiful sight. I know no one agrees with me, but it's beautiful. Sanctification is required after I've been at it for a while, and the once sharp edge is now dull. And then I put the metal gouge onto the rough stone of my grinder and do my best to delicately and precisely sharpen the blade of the gouge against a very rough surface. You see, a dull edge during wood turning is a very dangerous thing. I wear a face shield for a reason. Now, this may not be the best analogy ever, but justification is the sharpness, the blade that we receive as a gift, but it takes work to stand for sometimes hours at the grinder to make sure that it is It remains sharp in order for us to continue the good and beautiful work of creating life, creating something alongside God. It may not be the best analogy, but I hope it makes sense. Justification, as Dietrich Bonhoeffer wrote in The Cost of Discipleship, is the means whereby we appropriate the saving act of God in the past, and sanctification, the promise of God's activity in the present and the future. Justification secured our entrance into fellowship and communion with Christ through the unique and final event of His death, and sanctification keeps us in that fellowship in Christ. Justification makes the individual a member of Christ's church and Christ's kingdom, whereas sanctification preserves the church with all its members. Justification enables the believer to break away from his or her sinful past. Sanctification enables him or her to abide in Christ, to persevere in faith and to grow in love in the present and into the future. Repentance, therefore, is twofold. To repent first is to acknowledge our sinfulness through confession and the assurance of forgiveness, that is, the grace gift offered in the death and resurrection of Jesus. And second, to repent is to actively work with Jesus to transform and restore our lives and to join Jesus in the work of transforming and restoring our world. As we seek to better understand repentance, it may be helpful to clarify our definition of sin. If I were to ask you to define the word sin, how would you answer it? I would assume you would probably say something like, sin is anything that disobeys God, or sin is breaking God's laws. And if this is your answer, you're not wrong, but these definitions don't tell the whole story. Here's another definition. Sin is the culpable disturbance of shalom. Shalom, of course, means peace, but it's more than just the opposite of war or conflict or the freedom from disturbance. Hebrew-speaking people understood shalom to mean wholeness. Shalom is the harmony God intends for the world. Shalom is how God wants things to be. Shalom is peace with yourself, with your neighbor, with the earth, with God. We are sinners because we are guilty of disrupting peace and harmony and wholeness in us and around us. And so to repent with regards to being justified is to seek forgiveness for the ways we have disrupted shalom. To repent is to say, I'm sorry, and to hear, I forgive you. Forgiveness, however, is a starting place, not a stopping place. Forgiveness is God's gift to those who wish to begin again. But where we go with it is up to us. Most of us prefer remorse to repentance. We would rather feel badly about the damage we have done than get estimates on the cost of repair. We would rather learn to live with guilt than face the hard work of new life. True repentance seeks to restore peace and wholeness. True repentance works to modulate from dissonance to harmony. True repentance is the active work of Jesus and the Holy Spirit in and through us to restore our lives and our world to the way God intended. Repentance that leads to justification or sanctification does not stop at I'm sorry, but continues by asking, what must I change in my life, and what must I do to live more fully into the image of Christ? How can I live into and out of my God-given purpose? What needs to be dug up or pruned away or fertilized so that I can bear more fruit? When it's all said and done, the work of justification has already been accomplished by Jesus. There's nothing we did or can do other than to confess our sinfulness and need for forgiveness and to have faith in the saving grace of Jesus. This is the first step of repentance, but the real work of repentance begins at the work of sanctification that seeks daily transformation, daily sharpening, daily pruning as we gradually move toward holiness. This is done when we allow our vineyard keeper to dig around, to prune, to fertilize, so that we might bear more fruit. The green mile of Lent involves some dirty work that is a lot like cultivating Sometimes it can feel like we are stuck in the manure of it all, and it may require us to prune ourselves. But if we aren't willing to get our hands dirty so that we might produce fruit, then our lives really are meaningless. And we're just taking up space in the vineyard. God's purpose for us is to bear fruit, for new life to spring forth from us, which is why our Lenten mile is green, because new life, resurrected life, is found on the journey and at the end of the journey. The sin of the fig tree was not that it did something bad, but that it did nothing. It was just taking up space in the vineyard. And so if our branches and limbs are barren and lifeless, then we might as well be cut down too. We must get to work digging around the soil and heaping on some fertilizer. We must get to work pruning away the dead branches and limbs and removing the invasive growth that tries to swallow us up. We must get to the work of repentance with Jesus, our vineyard keeper, so that we aren't just taking up space in the vineyard. True repentance restores wholeness. True repentance resolves to harmony. True repentance leads to reconciliation and redemption and renewal. True repentance repairs shalom. Repentance is tough and dirty work, but it's absolutely worth the effort and the mess, because you will be restored and your life will be full of fruit. You will be transformed, and so will the world. If we want to bear any fruit, and if we want to have any part in sharing God's redemptive love and restoring grace with the world, then we better get to work. Because there's no reason why anyone should ever believe our talk of God's transforming power unless they can also see that transformation taking place in us and through us and in the world. We are the people God has chosen to embody the gospel. You have been planted in God's vineyard, and your vineyard keeper is ready to get to work. You are God's beloved. Repent and live. Amen. God of steadfast love, imagination of the ages, you offer to all the world, you offer to all that world where all thirst is quenched, all the hungry are fed, all strangers become family. Jesus, friend of the poor, brainstormer of the kingdom, you dare to envision that world where we do not waste a single person, but offer hope to those in despair, bring light into every shadow, embrace the lonely and broken. Spirit of discernment, artist of our lives, you inspire us not to toss aside any of the gifts of God, but to offer peace to angry hearts, to share joy with mourners, to welcome those whose ways are not ours. Gracious and eternal God, you call us into a new way of being and give us so many second chances in life. May your love wash over us as we turn toward you, cultivate and restore our lives that we might bear fruit. Mold us as your people in new and powerful ways. Redeem and transform us that we may be true disciples of your Son, Jesus Christ. God in community, holy in one, continue to nurture us with steadfast grace, even as we pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here in worship today. Those words, repent and die, are quite harsh, but may you hear today the words repent and live, because that is what Jesus is inviting us into. There's some thoughts on repentance for the week ahead there for you to read on your own time. Of course, I like leaving you with something for the week ahead, but hear now these words as our benediction. May Christ go before you to prepare your way. May Christ go behind you on days when you feel like retreating to encourage you one step forward at a time. May Christ go to your right and Christ to your left, abiding closer than even a brother or a sister. May Christ go above you on the days when the dark clouds roll in to remind you that there is one above the clouds who at the end of the day has the final word. May Christ go beneath you, girding you with confidence and removing all forms of fear. But mostly, may Christ go within you, transforming you from the inside out until your heart beats in rhythm with His. Amen.